Good morning, students. So today we are going to start the poem A Photograph, composed by Shirley Toulson. So Harshnoor Singh beta, okay. So A Photograph, written by Shirley Toulson. You must all have, you know, got many photographs. Earlier, people used to click photographs with the help of cameras, but now is a time for selfies and all. So no. Even now, you can say like taking selfies has become much of an obsession with many of our youngsters. And the very purpose, maybe it's a photograph, maybe it's a selfie. What's the basic purpose of clicking a photograph? What's the basic purpose behind it? Yes, you can send me the message. So why do we go for a photograph or a selfie? Yes. It's okay. Yes, Amrithi, the basic purpose of clicking photographs or going in for selfies is to capture the memories. Okay, whatever moment we are living in, we want to capture it. Why do we want to capture the present moment? Because this time, which now we are living, will not come back. Okay, this present will not come back. So in order to see, in order to relive this moment somewhere in future, we capture the moment, right? So either to capture the good moments, basically, Himanshu, yes, you're right. But basically our purpose is to capture the good moments. We don't want to relive the bad moments again and again. Okay, we always want to relive the good moments. So when you people go for a party or when you people go for a celebration, when you people are happy, when you're simply having fun, then only people go for selfies. And when there is some trouble, then very, very rarely somebody goes in for selfies or then somebody clicks photographs. Okay, so the purpose is always to celebrate this present moment somewhere in the future. Because the reality is like a time and tide waits for none. Because like the present moment will not come back again. So whatever you might do in future, even if you would want to relive this present moment, which is now at 10:59, this moment will never ever come back in our life. So that's why even the sages, you know, they very sagaciously always say, like if you want to be the best in your life, if you want to do something worthwhile in your life, then always take care of your present. Because when you take care of your present, the future will automatically take care of itself. The future will be by default safe. So present is very important. So living present moment, living it to the utmost satisfaction, okay, is very important, right? So here is a poem with us, A Photograph. This photograph, you know, the very title is a bit ironic. The very title is, you know, a little ironic. The photograph which is captured in this poem, the photograph which is being talked about in this poem, that very moment, that very photograph refers to a moment which actually refers to a good time. But later on, that very moment becomes the reason of sadness. That very moment becomes a reason of some loss for that very person, the one whose photograph is there. So it's very ironic that the moment which you clicked to capture its beauty or to capture its joy, that very moment later on became a source of unhappiness or sadness because you cannot relive that moment again. So there is an irony in the title itself. So here, photograph. Let's first read the photograph text, then we'll be discussing its depth. The cardboard shows me how it was when the two girl cousins went paddling, each one holding one of my mother's hands. And she, the big girl, some 12 years or so, all three stood still to smile through their hair at the uncle with the camera. A sweet face, my mother's, that was before I was born. And the sea, which appears to have changed less. washed their terribly transient feet. Some 20, 30 years later, she would laugh at the snapshot. "See Betty and Dolly," she would say, "and look how they dressed us for the beach." The sea holiday was her past. Mine is her laughter. Both writhe with a labored ease of loss. Now, she's been dead nearly as many years as that girl lived. And of this circumstance, there is nothing to say at all. Its silence silences. So children, this is the text of the poem. And as per the text, there are three stanzas. The very first stanza, there the poet has described the photograph. Like, what's there in the photograph? Who is there in the photograph? Who's there in the photograph? It's the photograph of mother. It's the photograph of poet's mother. When she was 12 years old. At that time, she had gone to the sea. She had gone to enjoy a sea holiday with her two girl cousins, Betty and Dolly. So there she was photographed by her uncle. So she was enjoying a sea holiday. She was enjoying a few moments at the sea beach. So there the uncle photographed them. So the poet's main attention is, the poet is giving, you know, all concentration to one girl who's the biggest or the eldest of three girls. It's her own mother. So the poet is focusing upon one girl that is the eldest of three, and that eldest girl actually is the poet's mother, right? So that time when she was being clicked, then she was so beautiful, she was so young, and she was so happy because she was only 12 years old. She did not have any, you know, responsibilities of life. She was living a very carefree life, and she was all, you know, she had all that, all the reasons to be happy at that time. Second stanza is, it is when the mother is about 12 plus 13. How many? When the photograph was clicked, she was 12 years old. Later on, after 30 years, she might have been 30 plus 12. She might have been above 40. She might have been somewhat 42 or so. And then at that age, she would look at her photograph. Yeah, 42. So at that age, when she would be 42 years old, what she would do, she would look at the photograph. And when she would look at the photograph, she would be reminded of the sea holiday. So she would remember like how happy she was at the time, how beautiful she looked, how young she was at the time, what kind of, you know, happiness, you know, was there on her face at the time. So all these things made her, on one side, of course, she would remember that happiness. But now, because that happiness, that time cannot come back, that would make her a little unhappy. That would make her sad. So the loss of that happy time would make her sad in the second stanza. So second stanza is about the time when mother is 42 or so, when she's middle-aged woman. When she's remembering her past. So when she's remembering her past, when she's looking at the photograph, she would laugh. So when she's laughing while looking at the photograph, the poet is herself sitting there. The poet is looking at her and enjoys her mother laughing. The poet enjoys the sight of mother looking at the photograph and laughing. Got it? So what was the poet's mother's past? Poet's mother's past was her sea holiday. Now, in the second stanza, we find the poet sitting with her mother, and she finds that her mother is bemused, or she is amused at the photograph. She finds the photograph quite amusing. She laughs. That's okay. The poet enjoys this, that her mother is laughing. Whatever is the reason. Then in the third stanza, we talk about the time when even mother is not there. In first stanza, mother was 12 years old. In second stanza, mother is about 42. That is an approximate, because the poet says that after 20 or 30, she might have been 32 or she might have been 42. Exactly, we can't say. So after, in the second stanza, the mother was about a middle-aged, a very responsible, mother, and you can say a housemaker. And in the third stanza, that mother is no more. She is dead. When did she die? She died about 12 years or so. In the third stanza, we find mother died about 12 years ago. Okay? So, at that time, the poet says that I have now nothing to say, because the death of a mother has made her speechless. The silence of a mother, the occasion, the event of a mother's death has made her devoid of all words. She cannot express herself. She cannot express her sorrow. When you're happy, you may have hundreds of things to tell somebody, like why are you happy, how you feel at that time. But when one is sad, one doesn't find even a single word to express one's sorrow. Right? So this poem, A Photograph, actually, it's a big comment upon like how time passes, how time and tide waits for none. Time is the biggest leveler, it spares none. This poem is a big comment upon the transitory nature of life. Transitory means short-lived. Like this life is very short. Man is mortal. Man has to die one day. But man is mortal, but nature is immortal. Nature remains as it is. So this poem is all about the philosophy that man is mortal. Man's life is very short. And within this short time, within this short span of life, man, undergoes various phases. The phase of childhood, the phase of, adulthood or maturity, then old age, then death. But eventually death comes. And throughout the life, does the things as he has to do as per the life, as per the way the life asks him to do. But nature, on the other hand, is immortal. Nature doesn't ever come to an end. So there is a poem you people might have heard, a brook, the brook. The brook is a river. And in that poem, the brook, that poem was written by Lord Tennyson. So in that poem, Lord Tennyson, had personified the poem, the river, the brook. And brook says, men may come and men may go, but I go on forever. I go on and on forever. So that meant that brook says, the river says that man is mortal, but I'm not mortal, I am immortal. I stay there forever. So the same kind of, idea has been portrayed in this very poem, A Photograph. Now let's see this poem again. The cardboard shows me how it was when the two girl cousins went paddling. So the cardboard shows me. What's a cardboard? It's a wooden framework which holds the photograph, which keeps the photograph intact. What's a cardboard? It's a wooden framework in which you keep the photograph so that photograph remains intact. Nowadays, we don't find those kinds of cardboards in our houses. Okay, some people might have the cardboards of their old grandparents. Their grandparents might be having the cardboards with the pictures inside them. But nowadays, it's not the trend. But earlier, it used to be there. In earlier times, people used to keep the photograph in a cardboard so that the photograph remains intact. So for a cardboard here, this word has been personified. Cardboard is otherwise a non-living thing. The cardboard shows me. Can a non-living thing show you something? No. But here the cardboard is showing the poet how it was when the two girl cousins went paddling. So the cardboard, the wooden framework, which kept the photograph safe and intact. That cardboard, that photograph made the poet see like how the two girl cousins, how it was when the two girl cousins went paddling. So it was the photograph, it was that cardboard, which showed like how the two girl cousins went to enjoy a sea holiday with mother. Whose two cousins were there? These two girl cousins were of mother, poet's mother. So you come to know, the poet came to know about that sea holiday where the two girl cousins went with her mother. Okay, so the cardboard shows me, how did the poet come to know about that sea holiday? She came to know about that sea holiday from the cardboard or from that photograph. How it was when the two girl cousins went paddling, each one holding one of my mother's hand. So those two girl cousins, they were holding mother's hands from each side. And she, the big girl. So who is the big girl? The poet's mother. Poet's mother is the eldest of all the three girls. Two girl cousins and one mother. So three girls are there. And out of these three girls, poet's mother is eldest of all. And she, the big girl. She is the eldest of all. Some 12 years or so. And in the photograph, she is about 12 years of age. All three stood still to smile through their hair at the uncle with the camera. So when they had gone to the sea to enjoy paddling, their uncle also went with them. The three girl cousins, three girls went there along with their uncle. So the uncle might have asked them to pose for a photograph. And in order to pose for the photograph, the girls stood still. All three stood still. So all the girls stood still because they were posing for the photograph. In order to pose for the photograph, the girls stood motionless to smile through their hair. So while posing for a photograph, when we know that we are going to take a selfie, or when somebody is going to take our photograph, all human beings tend to smile. So all these girls, you know, they smiled through their hair. So what is through their hair? Actually, it was a seashore, it was a sea beach, and it was, of course, the wind. It might have been a windy day also. And moreover, their hair might have been open. So the hair might have been, a film of hair might have covered their mouths. Which mouths? Which were smiling. So when uncle was taking the photograph, then their hair, a film of hair might have covered their face, might have covered their mouth, which was showing that they were all smiles. A film of hair might have covered a part of their face, or it might have covered their mouth. And it was evident through that film of hair that they were smiling, because they were posing for the photograph. All three stood still to smile through their hair. So when uncle asked them to pose for the photograph, they stood still and smiled. And during this time, a film of hair covered their mouth. And through that film of hair, through their whisking of the hair, the smile was evident. At the uncle with the camera. So it was the uncle who was taking the photograph, because he had the camera with him. A sweet face, my mother's. So the poet, I told you earlier also, the poet is concentrating on one face. Otherwise in the photograph, there are three cousins, three girls are there. But the poet is focusing upon only one girl. That girl is the poet's mother. And that girl had a sweet face. She looked very innocent. She looked very youthful. My mother's. That was before I was born. So the poet says that my mother looked so beautiful. She looked so young and innocent. And that was a time when the poet was not even born. Because at that time, mother was only 12 years of age. Then how could the poet been born over there? So it was a time when the poet's mother was herself a child. And the sea, which appears to have changed less, washed their terribly transient feet. So it was a time when she was being photographed. Then the photograph depicted What can you see in the photograph? One thing you can see in the photograph is like three of the girls were smiling through their hair. Another thing you can see in the photograph was like they were standing still. One, they were standing still. Second, they were smiling through their hair. Third thing, that she had a sweet face. Fourth thing, that was very, very clearly visible in the photograph, that was that their feet were visible. And it was also visible that the sea waves were washing their feet. What was very clearly visible in the photograph? The sea waves were washing the feet of the girls. The point is, because they were standing at the seashore, they were getting themselves clicked at the sea beach. So when they were at the sea beach, the sea waves would be coming and they were touching the feet of the girls. So this is very important, children. And the sea, which appears to have changed less, washed their terribly transient feet. So first of all, see what is terribly. Terribly means extremely. And transient means short-lived. Transitory. Transient word has come from the word transitory. And transitory means short-lived. Okay? Which cannot span for a longer time. Which cannot go on and on forever. Transitory. Short-lived. Temporary. So, and the sea. So, in the photograph, the poet says that she can see the sea which hasn't changed over the years. The photograph also shows the sea which has remained the same even now. And that sea seems to be, it. That sea also is washing the feet of the girls. But what kind of feet? Transient feet. So the sea, which has not changed over the years, but is washing the transitory feet of the girls. How can there be the transitory feet of the girls? Can you say that somebody has a short-lived feet? It's not the feet which are short-lived. It is human life which is short-lived. So here, feet actually denotes the whole human being. Feet denote a human being. Feet denote the girls. So over here, feet, whose feet are these? These are the feet of the girls. So the photograph shows that the sea waves were washing their feet. Right? Till now, it's okay. When you say like the sea waves were washing their feet, it's okay. But when the poet says that it was washing their terribly transient feet. So feet cannot be transitory. It is a human life which is transitory, which is short-lived. So the sea waves were washing their feet. That is, the sea waves were washing the footprints made upon sand by these three girls. So the sea waves were washing the footprints of these girls side by side. The photograph shows that human life, that the photograph shows it very clearly that the sea waves were washing or were clearing the footprints of these girls which were made on the sand. So what actually is the main concept here? Terribly transient feet. Here, transient feet actually refers to the transitoriness of human life. Feet cannot be transitory. It's a human life which is transitory. So where a part refers to the whole. Here, feet refers to the whole human life. Then we call this poetic device as synecdoche. What poetic device is there? It is synecdoche. So here the poet says that the sea, which seems to have changed less, because sea is nature and nature is not permanent. Nature is permanent. Nature is imperishable. Nature stays there forever. Nature is immortal. And in contrast to nature is human life, which is mortal. So human life is mortal. Human life is transitory. That's why the poet says that the sea, which seems to have changed less over these years, is able to wash off the footprints of these girls, which were made upon the time, which were made upon the sand of that time. So the point is, time is a biggest leveler. Time doesn't spare anyone.
So here, terribly transient feet. Here the main poetic device, the major poetic device used is synecdoche. Synecdoche is a poetic device. Are you children noting down? Synecdoche is a poetic device which is used to convey, which is used to convey the part as a whole. Here feet refer to the whole, that is feet refer to the human life. Here feet refer to the human life. So one more poetic device is there, terribly transient feet. Terribly transient. Here ter sound is similar. Here ter sound has been repeated. Ter, T for terribly, T for transient. So here another poetic device is, yes, alliteration. There, the alliteration had come earlier also. Can you tell me where was the other poetic device? Where was this alliteration used earlier in the same stanza? Come on. All three stood still to smile through their hair. Stood still to smile. That is also alliteration. So S for stood, S for still, and S for smile. So stood, still, smile. These three words, you know, they start with the sir sound. And whenever we have consecutive words, start consecutive words with the same consonant sound, we call it alliteration, right? So alliteration is stood, still to smile, and afterwards terribly transient. These two are examples of alliteration. Then if we talk about transient feet, then it is the example of synecdoche. And synecdoche is a poetic device where a part refers to the whole. What refers to the whole? Feet refers to human life. Feet have been, here the feet have been referred to as transitory. But it's not the feet which are short-lived. It's a human life which is short-lived. So the first stanza is only basically talks about the fact like the girls who had gone to enjoy a sea holiday at the beach, their photograph was clicked by uncle. So the photograph which expressed their happiness, which expressed their youth, beauty, that beauty and youth could not could not be sustained forever. The sea remained as it is, but the girls who were so beautiful, who were so young in that picture, they did not remain that young and beautiful with passage of time. But sea remained as it is. Okay, the kind of sea it looked in the photograph, now also the sea might be all the more same. Got it? Some 20, 30 years later, she would laugh at the snapshot. See, Betty and Dolly, she would say, and look how they dressed us for the beach. Some 20 or 30 years later. So it was in the first paragraph, in the first stanza, we read out like the girl, the mother was about 12 years. But now, after 20 or 30 years later, she would laugh at the snapshot. Who is she? Mother. Poet's mother. So after 20 or 30 years later on, mother would pick up the photograph, mother would have the photograph in her hand and she would laugh at it. Okay, she would find the photograph quite amusing. After 20 or 30 years, the same photograph when she would look at, she would find it very amusing. Children, it's a very natural phenomenon. You people also might be remembering, like when you people were very small, maybe 1 or 2 or 3 or whatever, your parents might have clicked your photographs. So at that time, they might have clicked the photographs very seriously, like, wow, looking so beautiful. Our child is looking so good as a Kanhaji or as a superhero or something like that. So sometimes your photographs might have been taken when you people might have been taking a bath in the bathtub. So at the time, whatever the photographs were clicked. But now, when you are grown-ups, when you look at those photographs, sometimes you feel embarrassed and sometimes you feel amused when you look at the photograph. And the whole family laughs when you see the photographs, right? Then your parents also describe like, yes, you looked so cute. Now you have changed this or that. You were so
cheerful, but no, you never laugh.
So sometimes, you know, the photographs bring those moments back. And when you look at the photograph, then you relive the past and then you laugh. Okay? So here is the same thing. So after 20 or 30 years later, when mother would look at the photograph, she would laugh. What would she say then? See, Betty and Dolly, she would say, and look how they dressed us for the beach. So what would she say when she would look at the photograph? Number one, she would laugh. She would be amused while looking at the photograph. And then she would say, like, see how those girls, what were the names of her cousins? One was Betty and the other was Dolly. So she would comment upon, like, see how they made us dress up for the beach. How funnily we were dressed up. See how we were dressed up. And see, look how they dressed us for the beach. So point is, now she's laughing at the way they were dressed up at that time. At that time, when she was 12 years of age, then she might have found her dress to be the most befitting dress. But after 20 or 30 years, she finds the same dress. She might be, not exactly, I can't say this. She might be finding that dress a little funny. That is what the tone of the line is. See how they dressed us for the beach. So she finds that dress to be very funny. And she laughs at while looking at the photograph. The sea holiday was her past. Now the poet says that the sea holiday was the past of my mother. The sea holiday was the time when she had the time of happiness, when she lived the most beautiful moments of her life. But now that past cannot come back. So that past moment, that past memory, that memory of sea holiday was her past. So the memory of the sea holiday was past of poet's mother. Mine is her laughter. But for me, her laughter is my past. Why? Because when mother would look at the photograph and smile, then poet would look at her and would enjoy her laughing, enjoy her laughter. So mother's past was her holiday and poet's past was her mother's laughter. Is this point clear? What was the mother's past? What was the poet's mother's past? Her mother's past was her sea holiday. Note it down. And what was poet's past? The poet's past was her mother's laughter while looking at the photograph. Got it? So when mother would look at the photograph, then she would laugh. And that has become the past of poet. Remember, there are two memories now. One memory is the memory of mother. Another memory is the memory of poet's. Poet's memory and poet's mother's memory. Got it? The sea holiday was her past. Mine is her laughter. Both rhyme with a labored ease of loss. Underline this line, children. This is the theme of the poem. This is most important line of the poem. Both rhyme with the labored ease of loss. First of all, try to understand the meaning of almost each word of this line. Both here refers to poet as well as her mother. Both refers to poet's mother as well as poet. Right? Both rhyme. Rhyme means, rhyme actually has got a facial expression. It refers to the facial expression. Which becomes distorted because of pain, anguish, or disappointment. And moreover, rai also has an ironic sense also. Rai, W-R-Y, rai refers to distorted facial expression because of anger or disappointment, or because of change in situation or time. It's very important. You might not understand this meaning later on. You can ask me again. Rye is a distorted